Hello and welcome to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up, we're going to take a look at Windows Virtual Desktop, a new remote desktop solution on Azure, and we're going to show you how you can now use Windows 10 Enterprise to allow multiple users, which used to only be possible on a Windows server, and we're going to show you steps for getting the service up and running in minutes. And as you migrate to Windows 10, we're also going to talk about how you can now run Windows 7 if you need to and benefit from 3 years of extended security updates with Azure. And to do all this, I'm joined by my partner in crime here, Scott Manchester, from the Desktop Virtualization team. Welcome.
Thanks, Jeremy. Good to be back.
Thank you. So we've got a lot of great news to talk about. And I think that a lot of people are probably in the process of upgrading their Windows 7 or earlier versions of Windows 10 machines up to the latest and greatest. And they might be looking at virtual desktop solutions or desktop virtualization. How does this new option with Windows Virtual Desktop change things?
Well, if you are working on an upgrade from Windows 7 or older to Windows 10, or you're working on a migration from your own data center to the cloud, Windows Virtual Desktop now provides a new option that minimizes your IT admin overhead and provides a cost-effective and more secure solution to remote applications and desktops to any endpoint. Last year, Jeremy and I were here on stage, and we talked about RDMI, which was a set of Azure app services to manage your virtual environment. Well, this has evolved now based on feedback from you and other customers into a fully managed Azure service. And additionally, with Windows Virtual Desktop, we allow you to run both remote apps and desktop sessions on Azure with Windows 10 with multiple simultaneous users. And this now enables you as an IT admin to deploy Windows 10 Enterprise with either persistent desktops or non-persistent multi-user session host farms.
Right. This significantly then reduces the overhead for IT admins because effectively Microsoft is managing that virtualization infrastructure, all the servers that you'd have to do in the past. So what's then the benefit of architecting for multiple concurrent users against a single OS or single VM?
It really comes down to resource utilization. In a single VM per user model, you typically size each user's VM based on their anticipated peak usage. But in a typical workday, a task or office worker rarely is consuming the peak capacity of their VM. But you're still paying for that peak processing power and memory. So let's consider a real-world scenario. So let's say we have 24 users, and their peak usage would require 2 virtual CPUs and 4 gigabytes per RAM per user. So instead of having 24 dedicated machines with a total of 48 virtual CPUs and 96 gigs of RAM, with Windows Virtual Desktop and Windows 10 with multi-user capability, we can deploy a single VM with 8 virtual CPUs and 32 gigs of RAM and host all 24 users on this single VM. And with this configuration, we have reduced the resource requirements by more than 80% and still providing a great user experience for those users.
It's really an awesome amount of resource and cost savings, about 96 versus 32 gigs, you know, fewer CPUs. But can IT then adjust the behavior of this?
Absolutely. We've built this to be flexible. So you can choose any size VM from the Azure catalog and vary the density of users on the VM based on the type of workload they're running. And we're going to give a demo of that in a minute. Mm-hmm. And you also have agility in how you distribute the users across these VMs. We have several modes for load balancing users across the host pool. So let's say you want to optimize your deployment for performance. So for a group of 120 users, you spin up 5 VMs for users to log into. And for best performance, you can configure our load balancing algorithm to breadth mode. And with breadth mode, we evenly allocate the users across these VMs to distribute the workload. But if you wanted to optimize for cost savings, you can configure the host pool for our depth mode load balancing. And in this mode, we'll fully allocate users to one VM before moving to the next. Combine this with our scaling tools, and now you can spin up additional VMs as needed once a specified threshold has been met to support the incoming demand of users. Mm-hmm. And we provide these scaling tools, but you can create your own based on your own personal needs. And this flexibility allows you to optimize for both cost and performance while still ensuring users are getting a great experience.
All right, but I want to talk about this multi-user mode. What are the other advantages from a Windows 10 perspective for multi-user?
Well, the main advantage is consistency. Unlike Windows Full Server, which was traditionally used for multi-session mode, Windows 10 Enterprise is released on the semi-annual channel. So for you as IT admins, this means testing and validation is greatly simplified because Windows Enterprise is released on a consistent cadence now for your desktops, your laptops, and now your virtualization environment. And for users, this means they get a consistent experience now across their personal desktops. For example, a user can now have access to modern apps like Edge, Cortana, and Universal apps as well in a multi-session environment. And Windows 10 Enterprise Multi-User is highly optimized to run Office 365 applications like Outlook, OneNote, and OneDrive in a non-persistent multi-session environment.
Right, so I see the advantages then of using Windows 10 Multi-User, but from an IT admin perspective, and I think pretty much everyone here watching is an IT admin, how do we actually manage all of this?
Well, Windows Virtual Desktop reduces the overhead in managing your virtualization environment. We provide the remote desktop infrastructure roles, such as your gateway, broker, diagnostics, and RDWeb. They're now all offered as a complete service on Azure, and it's designed with simplicity and security in mind. And you keep your virtual network secure now because we establish an outbound connection from your environment to the service in Azure.
Very cool. So what's the responsibility then as an IT admin? What do I actually do then day to day?
Well, this means you as an IT admin, you are in control of your Windows images, applications in our host pools. And you can use your existing tools like SCCM and Intune to manage those.
All right, so no need to look after all of those infrastructure roles, keep those servers patched, all the things that you would have had to do. But what are your options then to run VMs in this environment?
Well, we'll have a complete set of images in the gallery, but you can also upload your own custom image as well. And ultimately, you only need to pay for the resources that are consumed in your subscription, so the IaaS that you're using to host these apps and desktops. Everything else is provided with the service.
Right. So I've got an idea now of what Windows Virtual Desktop is. I think everybody else does. Does anybody want to see a demo? I think a few people want to see a demonstration of this working live. Let's do it. It's brand new.
All right. So let's switch over to my machine here. So here I'm in the Azure portal. And all I've done here is I've clicked Create a New Resource. I've typed in Windows Virtual, searched through the entire Azure Marketplace catalog, and found this new option, which is Windows Virtual Desktop. Now, this will be released when we go in public preview, but for now, this has been whitelisted into my subscription. So I'm actually going to go through the process of creating our very first host pool. So I'll click Create here, and let's do this live.
All right, so what does a host pool do then exactly? What are we doing here?
So a host pool is a collection of VMs that you can build for each of your different departments that host either apps or full desktops, and it allows you to customize the size of the VM for the particular workload that you have configured. So if you want to set up VMs for your IT department, and these guys need big VMs and they need admin privileges, then you could create a host pool for them that was right size for their workloads. And maybe your task or office workers, you want to put them on a multi-user Windows 10 image and maybe get a higher density, maybe 3 or 4 users per core. Mm-hmm. So you can create different host pools that have different apps and are right size for the workloads that they're running.
Very good. Okay.
So first off, let me do this. I'm going to put in one or more UPNs for the admins that would be responsible for managing this service. And I'll just say admin, little control V there. Now I'm going to create this host pool. Let's say we want to create a host pool for the engineering department, right? So I'll just give this host pool a name. And now the assigned users here, I could put in individual users or I could put in a group, an AD group here. So I'm going to say this is my ENG group. And from here, I'm choosing the subscription that I'm going to deploy this into. And I can assign the resource group. So for simplicity, what I usually do is I give this the same name as the host pool. And I'm going to put a number just to make sure it's unique. And then I choose a location that I want to deploy this into. So that's it for the primary setting up the admin part. So now I'm going to go through and configure the VMs that are going to be part of this host pool.
Okay.
And as I mentioned earlier, I can use one of the images that we have in the Azure Gallery. And you'll notice that I have some new options here. Windows 10 Multi-User, Windows 10 Enterprise, of course, Windows 7 Enterprise.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, we support Server 2012 forward, all the way up to 2019.
So you can bring your own images, or you can use the ones in the gallery like we see here.
Yeah, if you're an IT admin and you want to take one of these images, create a VM, customize it, load your app, set your group policies, do all that stuff ahead of time, you can simply just give us the URI where that image is, and then we'll build the host pool based on that image.
Got it.
But for now, we're just going to choose one of the defaults in the gallery. I'm going to choose the standard SSD hard disk type. Now here is an interesting algorithm that we've created to make it easier for these IT admins to right-size their VMs. So I can choose the workload type here. And if you use tools like Login VSI, you're kind of familiar with this, personas of different users that have different capacity needs. And if you hover over our little info text here, it kind of gives you some other insights about what we're doing. But let's say that I want to support 100 users with a medium workload.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's telling me I'm going to need 4 VMs, 4 D8S V3s.
Okay.
Now, this is a default VM size that we've chosen, but you can override all these and put in the number of machines you want. You can choose any VM in the entire gallery, including end SKUs. So if you wanted to set up a host pool for your design team, for instance.
Right, you can have GPU support.
Yeah, you get full GPU support, and you can give them a one-to-one VM mapping, or you can use multi-session as well.
Very cool.
So I'm just going to keep the default here for the DS8v3, and I'll hit OK. And then everything's going to look very familiar to you after that, because now all that's left is for me just to determine the type of disk. I'm going to use manage disk here. And then just setting up the domain that I'm going to add these to. So let's just say we want to add it to our avdcontoso.com. I didn't spell that right. But here then, and I just provide the username and password for the admin that has privileges to add these machines to that domain.
Okay.
And then I click OK, and then create. And then it's just a standard VM creation process, which takes about 20 minutes.
Right, right. And this is, I mean, this took us a couple of minutes here to do a basically an Azure Resource Manager template to build that out. But this would have taken a long time to get all of this running in the real world. I've remember personally building out environments using all, you know, Windows or Windows Plus partner kind of solutions that take a week sometimes
That's
to provision.
Right.
This is about 5 minutes, and you can get something up and running.
Yeah, and what this does is this sets up a pre-configured host pool that's sharing the full desktop. Now, you can go inside of our tools and configure this to make it an app environment, single user, multi-user, and even set that breadth and depth mode way of doing our load balancing.
So what does it look like then once everything's running and you've been running for a week or a month?
Sure. So I'm going to go back to my dashboard here. And now we're going to simulate like a day 100, right? So I've had this service running for some time. I've set up multiple host pools. And this is a kind of a reasonable example of what you might see, where I've got different resource groups. And you can see I've named the resource groups kind of based on the teams within my organization that are using it. So here's a resource group for my finance org over here. I've got one for my accounting org. And then down here, I've got my IT org. So maybe my accounting and finance, they can run Windows 10 multi-user, right? They're running line of business apps that work in a multi-user environment, and I can provide a great experience for them there.
Okay.
But maybe my IT org needs to have admin privileges, and we need to give them, you know, larger VMs. So this host pool could be set up for more of a VDI-like scenario. So I have all that flexibility there.
Very cool, very cool. So we've seen creating host pools, adding users to the applications. Now that you've got an entire remote desktop infrastructure and you got it up and running in just a couple of minutes, you set this up in this case using Marketplace, but I'm guessing a lot of people out here, anybody use PowerShell or other methods?
PowerShell sounds familiar.
Jeffrey Snover was here last night, so
PowerShell. He'd be ashamed of you guys.
Yes. So can we use PowerShell or other approaches to build this out?
Yeah, we really spent a lot of time talking to admins and understand the tools that they use for building out deployments like this. So Windows Virtual Desktop starts off first with a full set of REST APIs. So you can automate this and integrate it into your existing IT automation tools like ServiceNow. We also have a complete set of PowerShell commandlets.
Mm-hmm.
We have this Azure Marketplace tool that'll be available when we go into public preview later this year. And then when we GA, we'll be developing a full Azure portal UX experience for both management and deployment. So pretty much any tool you want to use to build out your deployments, you can use those with Windows Virtual Desktop.
Very cool. And I think this might have been the first time this week where you actually started with the admin experience. But why don't we show what the end user experience then looks like using this?
Absolutely. We know our audience. We know they want to see the admin
right,
stuff.
Right, right. Exactly.
All right. But let's show you guys what it looks like in real world. So here I've got PowerPoint running here. And you can see PowerPoint running pretty smooth. I'm going to pin it to the left. I'm going to maximize it here.
So this, that's a remote app, basically, that's
this
running.
This looks and feels like a remote app. And if you look carefully down in my my tray down here, you'll see that it's got a little glyph over it telling me that it's a remote application.
Yep.
Without that little glyph, I probably wouldn't even know. It looks and feels like a native application. And all I had to do to get this running is put in my email address into the remote app and desktop control panel, and automatically all those apps that are created in that host pool were automatically added to my start menu. Whoops. So here you can see even the most recently added. Since I just subscribed to this feed earlier today, you can see there's everything there. And the name of that host pool was avdcontoso, and that's the name of the folder that is created. So it gives me a way of organizing the apps that are created for each host pool. But everything aggregates together in my start menu. So I can
see
different host pools. I can see full desktops. So let's run another app, and let's just see how fast this is. Boom. So you see just how quick I'm launching this application. Again, these look and feel like native apps. I can copy and paste between them if my IT admin is configured to enable me to do that.
Yep.
And the beauty of this is it just looks and feels like a native application. I'm getting a great Windows experience as a user.
Right. And last time you were on the show, you actually talked about HTML5 capabilities with remote desktop. Is that something that we can do here as well?
Yeah, absolutely. We brought all those rich RDMI capabilities forward, so we've got a full web interface. In fact, I've already set up an account for you. Why don't you show them what this looks like?
Okay, so let me try on my machine to see if I can sign in here.
Well, now, of course, this device is an unmanaged device, right? So this could be a laptop from a friend.
This is literally an unmanaged device that we use to like do demos on Microsoft Mechanics. It's had all kinds of people on it, and it's not joined to any domain. So
now, because you're on an unmanaged device and an untrusted device, we've set the policies with our AED for this domain that it's going to require multi-factor authentication. So if things go well, then you should get a two-factor challenge here.
I got the phone call. That's a good sign. I'll put on speaker.
Thank you for using the Microsoft sign-in verification system. Please press the pound key to finish your verification.
All right, let's see if that worked.
Your sign-in was successfully verified. Bye.
And there we go. We're inside. Awesome. So it's secured by Azure Active Directory.
Thank you.
You can clap.
AED,
come
people
on.
In the back.
That was probably joy in the back saying, I got Azure AD and RDS working together. Okay, so now let's go ahead and fire up a session desktop in this case. And I can use, this is pretty cool, I can use the host clipboard and the host printer if my admin allows that to happen.
That's right.
So I'm going to go ahead and click allow myself. And now the nice thing is it's got clipboard and printer access against my host machine. And now it's going to ask me one more time. And the nice thing was, because I did do that clipboard thing, I was able to just paste that in there.
Cheated.
I'm not that fast of a typer. I wish I was. All right, and now I've got a Windows 10 machine running inside of Windows 10. Let me just go back to the host for a second so I can full screen here, just so it looks a little bit nicer. All right, so even within the website in a website. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and close out of that. Now, the nice thing is I can go in. And one thing that I couldn't do before, especially if I was on a multi-user instance of a virtual machine, I couldn't launch Edge. So now I can actually launch Edge, and you'll see that it will even take me to the best page right now on the internet, which is the Windows Virtual Desktop Preview page. But question, now that I've got all this here, and I've got some things in my clipboard, or I've got some items maybe that I've been working on inside the virtual machine, will any of that then reside back on the host? Let's say if I'm in a hotel kiosk or somewhere else accessing this environment, what happens?
Yeah, that's the beauty of using virtualization. It provides a great security boundary. So even in my case, when I was running these apps that look and feel native, when I'm done, there's no residual data left behind. So I can keep all my corporate assets protected. This enables me to bring my own device, share a device, just use a browser. I can pretty much get in on any machine, get access to these corporate resources, and my IT admin knows that my assets are protected.
Very cool, and of course, I think a lot of people are on their way to Windows 10 and modern desktops, but what if I've got a few apps that I have around? Maybe they don't work in Windows 10, or the ISV makes me buy an upgrade that's super expensive, or it's not supported in Windows 10. What do I do then?
Yeah, we understand that there's a lot of people that are working on your migration from Windows 7 to Windows 10, but if you still have workloads that have dependencies on Windows 7, you can now take those Windows 7 workloads, you can move them up to Azure as part of Windows Virtual Desktop, and you'll get the free Windows 7 extended security updates after we go end of support in January 2020 with Windows 7. So really great option if you still got some Windows 7 workloads. Then give those users brand new shiny Windows 10 machines.
And it's all part of Windows Virtual Desktop?
It is. It's included. Yep. You just pay for the IaaS.
Very cool. So thanks for joining us today, Scott. Lots of great updates. Hopefully everybody loved what they saw today. What do you think?
Thank you.
And hopefully everybody online is happy as well. So when will people be able to start trying Windows Virtual Desktop for themselves?
Well, you can start later this year. You'll be able to use that as your marketplace tool, those REST APIs, and all the other tools we talked about to build out your own deployments. That'll be available later this year. If you go to this link here, you can sign up to get notified when the preview goes live.
Cool, and of course, we'll keep tracking all the updates and keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for the latest updates across Microsoft. And follow us on Twitter and subscribe to our YouTube. See you next time. Goodbye for now.